Hello everybody and welcome. I'm Brian DeMars for ChannelFireball.com, and today I'm going to be playing some Modern Affinity. Affinity, one of my favorite decks in Modern. I've played it a lot. I've probably played it at three or four GPs, and I'm pretty sure I've cashed all but one playing the deck. That's sort of a humble brag, but really it's a testament to the consistency of the Affinity. Affinity, probably if you broke down Modern as a format for the entirety that it has existed, I'm pretty sure Affinity has been in the tier one or very close to the tier one the entire time. And I don't think you can say that about any other deck because, well, all the other decks that would have been able to do that have been banned. But somehow Affinity lives on, fights on, shambles its little robot way towards victory over and over and over again. Affinity, just a great, great deck. So not a lot has really changed with the Affinity. It plays the best cards. It seems like every time there's a Mirrodin block, it gets some new toys. But we did get Spire of Industry in Kaladesh block, and Spire of Industry is awesome in this deck. It's kind of like a Glimmer Void, except it doesn't have the hefty drawback of just lose the Glimmer Void if you don't have any artifacts in play. So it makes you a little bit more robust, a little bit more not all in on your opponent, you know, shocking or lightning bolting or fatal pushing a one drop and then you having to lose your land because you had a double Glimmer Void draw, or just having to mulligan because your hand was fine but you couldn't support the Glimmer Void. So I guess let's go through the deck real quick. There's 17 lands in the deck, like I said. Spire of Industry, a fairly well-known piece of technology. I'm pretty sure everybody plays it because it's great. But other than that, the deck has 8 creature lands, 4 Blink Moth Nexus, 4 Ink Moth Nexus. So a lot of utility in the mana there because these are also flying threats that are quite awesome. 4 Citadels, which help power up your Mox Opals. I guess these Mox Opals could kind of come over here because they are essentially mana. So the Citadels power up the Opals. Then we have the Glimmer Voids and Spires to cast our colored spells, and a Mountain to get if we get Ghost Quartered or Pathed or whatever. We have several red spells in the main deck, so we go get our Mountain. Also, as we'll see in the sideboard, more red cards than blue in the sideboard. So that's the mana, 17 lands, 4 Mox Opals. I guess while we're at mana, Springleaf Drum, 4 of those. Also, you know, mana of any color sources. So the deck actually has a lot of access to colored mana. Has four sort of City of Brass lands in the Spires and Glimmer Voids, 4 Opals, and 4 Drums. So that's 12 sources of mana that are any color, plus a Mountain, which casts four of our spells there. So mana is quite great. The deck is sort of unique, and it plays a lot of zero drops. The 4 Opals, of course, but like also 4 Ornithopter, 2 Memnite, and a Welding Jar. This is sort of to turn the Opal on as quickly as possible. Also, just to... these cards are just good because we have cranial plating, so any body, especially a flying body like an Ornithopter, can wear a plating quite well and zoom in the air for large chunks of damage. So those are the zeros. The Welding Jar, good at protecting like a steel over a turn one or two steel overseer from like a Bolt or a Fatal Push or whatever. Also good at just protecting anything. It's good. I like one Welding Jar. I don't like going berserk on Welding Jars, but I think one is like a very safe, very mature number. Onto the one drops, we have 4 Galvanic Blast. Lightning Bolt, quite good. Galvanic Blast just does 4, even better. Great for racing. That 4-1 damage, or 4 damage for 1 mana ratio can't be beat. Also just good at picking off things that need to go. In particular, you might want to kill like a Devoted Druid or a Steel Overseer in the Mirror, or, you know, whatever, some infect creature that's threatening to blow your doors off. Signal Pest also teams up with these zero drops and the cheap one drops to just chunk more damage. It has like sort of pseudo flying, so it's a good target for the cranial plating to equip too. And then I guess while we're at one drops, technically not a one drop, you can spell snare it, but the Vault Scourge, we're going to pay Phyrexian mana, we're going to pay 2 life to get this 1-1 lifelink down. Just a 1-1 flyer is great. The lifelink is sort of gravy, because, you know, we have lots of things that build our artifacts up, the Overseer, the Plating, the Ravager. So having a flying lifelinker is a great place to dump extra power, because we'll gain life, which is really hot in a racing situation. So those are the zeros and ones. These are sort of like the synergy of the deck. None of these cards are particularly powerful on their own, with the exception of maybe a one damage four, one mana four damage spell. I mean, you wouldn't play Memnites and Ornithopters and Signal Pests and Vault Scourges in a deck that didn't have a ton of synergy. So, you know, over here 12, 7, 25. Most of the deck is synergy. It's all synergy based. It's things that work together to make mana, to have permanents in play, to put things onto, to put counters onto. So most of the deck is a synergy deck, but then we come over here. These are the real threats over here on the right: the Ravager, the Plating, the Overseer, the Champion, and the Master. These are the payoff cards for all of this synergy, and they're quite powerful. The Steel Overseer can come down as early as turn one and start dumping counters onto creatures. You know, we have tons of artifact creatures: Pest, Vault Scourge, Ornithopter, Memnite. Ravager is a nice place to put a +1/+1 counter. Also, the 8 creature lands. So there's a lot of places for Steel Overseer to dump those counters. The Plating, of course, is going to be great on a flyer. You know, forcing them to Lightning Bolt an Ornithopter that's attacking for 8, it means that they can't hit your better creatures like your Overseer and whatnot. So puts a lot of pressure on, forces your opponent to do things that they really don't want to do in order to stay alive. So that's Overseer, Plating, Ravager. Ravager is just one of the best Magic cards in the game. As far as creatures go, I'd be hard-pressed to think of a creature that I think is much better than Arcbound Ravager. If you think of one, drop it in the comments. But, I mean, Ravager dominating Vintage. I've played it in Legacy. It is probably the best card in this deck outside of Mox Opal. It's just an amazing Magic card. It's a 1-1 for 2. It has Modular, which means that when it goes to the graveyard, you can move all of the +1/+1 counters that were on it onto something else. Everything is an artifact. And you can sacrifice an artifact to put a +1/+1 counter on it. So it basically just means that, like, you can move every artifact in play is threatening to deal damage when you have a Ravager, because if they're tapped out, you could sack everything and put it somewhere that isn't being blocked and just kill your opponent. So it's a great value card, a great aggro card. It's kind of like a Sulfuric Vortex in a sense that it's threatening to make it so that no matter what your opponent does, damage is going to hit them. It's even a good grindy card. You can make it a little bit big, trade it with something on the board, and then move the modular counters onto a flyer. Also a good way to build a giant Vault Scourge in some of the pre-board games against decks that are going to be not killing things with push or fatal push or path to exile. So if they're like trying to bolt your stuff and you just make this 7/7 flying lifelinker with a Ravager, it's pretty grand. It's going to be hard for them to beat. So that's that. That's the two drops, which are great. Spell Snare, obviously very good against this deck because the two drops are all completely insane. Etched Champion, there's more. This format's more about like racing and doing broken things than it is grinding. I used to play a lot of Etched Champions back in the day when Jund was everywhere, just because Jund and Jeskai, like, they're trying to kill everything you do, and it's going to be very hard for them to kill a creature that has protection from all colors. But, you know, the format's a little bit less about that, a little bit more about going big. So Master of Ethereum, there's three of those in here, and I've been pretty happy with Master of Ethereum. Just like a 3 mana 6/6 to 12/12, and it buffs all of your creatures, which makes combat very difficult when your opponent is trying to trade little things with little things, and then all of a sudden your little things are bigger. You know, the Overseer's pumping counters onto things. Master, pretty great. The one downside of Master is that it is a color requirement, which, I mean, the deck has opals and drums and stuff, but that is, you know, the deck was a little more fluid when you didn't have to worry about drawing a color mana source every time. But the upside of this card in the current metagame is high enough that I think it's well worth it to play the Master of Ethereum. So with that in mind, that's the main deck of Affinity. It's pretty grand, pretty great. I'm going to go over here. I'm going to pull up the sideboard. We could talk about that a little bit. I mentioned that against grindy decks, Etched Champion is a boss. So Etched Champion is a boss in my sideboard here. A lot of times, you know, if they're bringing in Grudges and artifact removal. You want to bring in the Etch Champions. You can board out the other three drops, the Masters. That might come up if we play against Jund or Jeskai or whatever. But Etch Champion for when you need to grind a little bit, which is frequent enough, I suppose, that you want to grind a little bit. Graft Digger's Cage, good against a lot of the combo decks like Storm. It's good against Dredge, good against Collected Company. If you need to shut their graveyard off, you've got the Cage. If you need to shut off Court of Calling type stuff, Cage is going to be your card. I have one Ancient Grudge for the mirror match. You know, maybe you play against some Lantern, you have an Ancient Grudge. But I didn't go overboard on Ancient Grudges like a lot of people do. I do like Grid, though, in the mirror. Grid's pretty good. There are a lot of cards that make Grid not matter as much. Like, it's hard to grid away when your opponent is mastering. But I definitely like both of them on the play, and probably one on the draw against Affinity. Got a Bitter Blossom. This is for the grindy matchups as well. Two Thoughtseize, two Spell Pierce. These are my default cards against the various combo decks or decks that are going to be playing a lot of sideboard cards that wreck me, like Stony Silence. I want to have ways to stop those, interact with those from their opening hand. Thoughtseize it away, Spell Pierce it when they try and play it. That's really the best you can do. I don't like having the red-white infuse card. I can't remember what it's called, but that's like a one man, a two mana shatter, a one mana demystify. I don't like trying to demystify or Nature's Claim the Stony Silence as much as I like trying to interact with it early in the game, because as we noted, Mox Opal and Springleaf Drum both get shut off of casting anything when a Stony Silence is in play. So, you know, if you draw your Nature's Claim or your Demystify or whatever after they have the Stony Silence, unless you've drawn one of your four cards, Spire or Glimmer Void, you can't even cast it. So, I'd rather just go on this plan than try and kill it once it gets into play. I have Rule of Law. This is, I'm going to do this against Living End, against Storm, against those kind of decks. So Rule of Law, really for Storm, though. And then there's a Dispatch that I just moved out of my sideboard. And I would like that against, decks like Eldrazi, decks like Death Shadow, where they have creatures that are hard, that are big and hard to deal with. I can just dispatch them for one mana. So anyway, that is the Affinity. That's the version I'm playing anyway. It's we joke that it's just stock Affinity. There's nothing particularly spicy about it. I guess maybe the Rule of Laws out of the sideboard are a little spicy, or the Bitter Blossom, but I mean, this is as stock as it gets. It's like you could take a composite average of decks that have performed well for the main deck, and this is probably what you would get, or very close to it. So anyway, we're going to play some games with the Affinity. It's a deck that I'm very seriously considering playing for the RPTQ coming up next week. And it's a deck that I really like to play. It's a lot of fun. I've been playing it at the local game store this week. I did a tournament. I went 3-1 with it. I just like the deck a lot in general. I think it gives you a lot of play, a lot of outs. It's very powerful. I think it's one of the most well-rounded decks in Modern. Right now, I would say maybe Storm is the most powerful deck as far as what it can accomplish and how consistent it is, but Affinity's like right there with it. So if people are packing a ton of sideboard hate for the Storm, which I mean I am, I'm using a bunch of sideboard spots for combo matchups like that. Maybe a deck like Affinity gets a little bit better because people have less room for their artifact hate. They always have the artifact hate, but maybe they won't have so much, and it'll make this deck a little bit better position. So anyway, that's sort of my rundown on this Affinity list. I hope you enjoyed the deck. I hope you enjoy the videos. Hopefully we play some interesting games that make me scratch my head a little bit, because they're going to be tough. But sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're just one-sided blowouts, one way or the other, you know. Get that quick plating down, or they play a Stony Silence. So we'll have to find out and see. I'm looking forward to it. If you like the video, be sure to hit the like button. That matters for me a little bit. I like to see those likes. I like to see, you know, how many people are checking out the videos and whatnot. Also, I really enjoy interacting with the viewers out there in the comment section. So if you see a play, or you have a question, or a suggestion, or maybe you have some super sick affinity tech that isn't present in this deck, be sure to drop that in the comment section. I really like talking about that stuff. I'm more than happy to discuss various ideas about the decks that I write and I talk about. So if you have some ideas, I'd love to hear them. I'd love to talk about them. I'm sure the other viewers out there also appreciate you dropping your tech in there and giving them some things to think about while they're watching the videos or while they're tuning up their affinity deck. So be sure to do that if you have ideas or thoughts out there. And last but not least, if you like the video series, be sure to subscribe to the Channel Fireball YouTube channel. There are a ton of just truly excellent content providers out there right now for Channel Fireball, making videos every week. It is one of the best ways to gain an edge on the competition. There's so many just platinum pros, super high level deck builders and tuners, theorists, everything recording videos on there. So whether you're playing in a PPTQ or Friday Night Magic, or if you're preparing for an RPTQ or Grand Prix like I am, that is just an excellent way to see what the best players in the game are up to and what they're thinking, how they're playing, what they're playing, how they're approaching various matchups, how games are playing out, all of that stuff. So be sure to subscribe to that channel for the Channel Fireball YouTube channel. So anyway, in just a second, we'll get to round one. I'd like to thank you all for tuning in. I'm Brian DeMars for ChannelFireball.com, and I'll see you in round one in just a moment. Hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm Brian DeMars for ChannelFireball.com, and jamming some Modern Affinity. So it looks like I won the die roll. So I'll take the play. So this hand, It's not great, but I think it's within the realm of things that we can keep. Obviously, I'd like to have a hand that goes crazy, but this, you know, a couple steel overseers, so I'm going to keep it. I can cast them, which is great. So I'll keep. See if my opponent keeps their seven as well. Just going to open up on Vault Scourge, get this Ornithopter down, I guess. There's no reason not to. I guess I could hold the Ornithopter. I get Chalice zeroed by an Eldrazi Tron player, so I should probably just put the Ornithopter into play now that I think about it. So I'll play a Spire of Industry, add a colorless. Play this Vault Scourge. And then I'll play the Ornithopter and pass the turn. Next turn, probably drop a Steel Overseer. I guess it's also possible that I could draw like an Opal, and I might want a Cranial Plating equipped to the Thopter. So I guess it's fine. It's fair to do that. And that's it for the turn, so I'll ship it. Let's see what our opponent is playing. Mountain, probably a Goblin Guide here. Gonna get a little aggressive, take out this Vault Scourge. Picked up a Galvanic Blast, which could be useful. As the game goes on, let's Steel Overseer and pass the turn. Probably a Searing Blaze would be like about the worst thing that could happen here. I mean, they could also just have things that only go face. Either way, it's kind of bad because I'm not really super well set up to race. I could be set up to race if I draw land to get this plating deployed. Otherwise, it's probably just another sealed over... Never... Okay. So, this is going pretty poorly. I'm stuck playing one spell per turn. My opponent's playing one removal spell per turn. And I'm in... I kind of need to draw lands. Lands and spells, which is kind of awkward. Well, there's a land... and a spell. That's pretty grand. So I can plating equip, or I can just play the Overseer and leave up Galvanic Blast. I think that's probably the play. Just get this Overseer down. Leave the removal spell up in case they try and play a creature. It's only a shock. I don't have Metalcraft, but I hope that'll probably be decent enough. Goblin Guide, Swift Spear, Eidolon. These things all die to a shock, which is nice. If they don't play something, maybe I'll be able to get 4 damage out of it later in a racing situation. My play may very well just be plating equip on the Ornithopter, make them kill the Thopter next turn. Well, that's a great target for a little Galvanic Blast if I've ever seen one. Red. Get this little Lavamancer out of here. So I drew a Springleaf Drum. There's no good way to get this Springleaf Drum into play. I think the best play is probably just play the Cranial Plating here. I'll put it on the Thopter. Put a counter on all my creatures. I go to combat and get him for 4. Let's see what my opponent's up to. They do have a Rift Bolt that'll take out one of my creatures, I assume. Spiked again. Jeez, it's gonna be close. I'm not exactly winning this race, that's for sure. So there, no cards in hand. Just Citadel. Let's play the Citadel. Play the Drum. So I have 4 artifacts. I think the play here is I'll just put it on the Nexus, and that's like a 2-turn clock all by itself. So let's animate Nexus. Then equip the plating. We'll go to combat. Deck with both. I don't really care if my opponent plays a haste creature, because if they just have a creature, they lose to the Nexus. So I might as well take this damage, because there's no reason to block. Because if I have to block, I win the game. So let's see if my opponent can come up with a removal spell for the Nexus here. Okay, they didn't even make me make the decision. So let's go to sideboard. So potential cards that might be good. The champion is pretty decent. Spell Pierce is pretty decent. I don't really want Rule of Law. I don't really want Aether Grid. I don't want Thoughtseize. I don't really want Dispatch. So it's really just a question of if I want to add champions or spell pierces. I like the champions because there's a good chance that my opponent will have Artifact Hate, which will make the Masters a little bit worse. So I think I can board out. The Masters are good in a race, though. So maybe I'll board out. I do want to bring in some number of Spell Pierce because I want to counter the burn spells. So I'm going to bring in Spell Pierce. So I'll board out like maybe a couple Galvanic Blasts. I'll board out a Master for a champion. And I'm also lightening up a little bit on colored mana requirements, which is nice. I think I like just about everything else. Maybe I just want one more Galvanic Blast in place of one of these more expensive creatures, just in case they have the Grim Lavamancer. I'm still within my requisite number of colored mana sources. You know, I'm actually even, same as my starting number. I can technically usually go up by about one. But I feel like this battle is more about being, it's a lot about being nimble, not really jamming out giant monsters. The giant monsters, I mean, they're fine. It's just I don't want to, you know, get Shattering Spreed or whatever to lose everything, which is, I mean, definitely something that could happen here. So let's try it like this. I just want to be nimble. I want to get damage through. I want to turn the corner, which is going to be tough. So I have a land, an opal. This hand is great. Sort of great. It deploys all of its cards very quickly, which is good in this matchup, to be fair. It has an answer to pretty much everything. Let's see if we can pick up a land here. That'd be great. So I did pick up land, which is nice. So I get to play a lot of things, luckily, before the Eidolon comes down. So I'll play... Does it matter how I sequence it? I feel like it probably does. I'm going to make colored mana. Alright, so I'm going to play Spire. Drum. You always want to play your drums before your creatures so that they can't randomly get gut shotted in response to the drum. Something that comes up. So play Opal. I'll play Ornithopter. I'll play Memnite. Cast Signal Pest. And that'll be my turn. I've Spell Pierce and Galvanic Blast up. I'm attacking for 3 next turn. I have a 4 damage burn spell if I need it. Maybe I'll draw another Nexus. That would be awesome. I'd love to pick up a Blink Moth Nexus here. Let's see what's coming at me. Maybe a nice little Searing Blaze that I can Spell Pierce. I'm just going to take this. We'll see if we get a card. Oh no, I don't really want an Ornithopter. Well, I'm not going to Spell Pierce, or I'm not going to Galvanic Blast. I'm just going to take my damage. That's an interesting little choice. So I attack back for 3, and I take 2. I'll be behind in the race, but I'll have a 4 damage burn spell. So I'll play my Glimmer Void. Attack for 3. The question is, post-combat, do I want to play this Ornithopter? Do I want to take 2 to deal 1 every turn? I think the answer is yes. So I just need to get my opponent down to 4. And they're going to have to play spells as well. So this race is very live as it stands. And I can Spell Pierce to try and defend the Signal Pest here if I can. Because I'm not racing without the Signal Pest. But I could just, you know, I could peel like a Cranial Plating. I'll get the information of what's on top of my deck when my opponent attacks with the Goblin Guide. So that will very likely impact my decision on what to do with the 2 spells in my hand. This game's pretty close. It always feels bad when the Spell Pierce like kind of just doesn't work out. Because, you know, they could have just slammed like a Stony Silence or a Searing Blaze and this would be huge. So opponent taking some damage, sure. So I'm going to take 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, and go to 5. My opponent will be at 8. And then I'll attack back for 1, 2, 3, 4. An 8, and I attack back for 1, 2, 3, 4. One, two, three, four, yeah. Welding jar, okay. So I think this is going to be lethal, okay? Take 6 down to 5. Attack for 4. And then Galvanic Blast my opponent for 4. And I have a Spell Pierce in case anything goes wrong. Draw a little welding jar. As long as I don't play the welding jar, I think I have this locked up. So go to combat. Then my opponent will take some damage, and then I'll go to the dome with the Galvanic Blast. And that should seal the deal. Add red. And I've even got the Spell Pierce up in case... I don't even know what could possibly go wrong. I'm pretty sure my opponent is just dead. But my opponent's going to think it over just to make it miserable for the viewers at home. Alright, got that one. Pretty sweet. Easy game. Hello everybody, welcome back. Brian DeMars here for ChannelFireball.com, playing some Affinity and Modern. I'm on the draw... And my hand is, I think this hand is, it's not great. It's not one of those great synergy hands, but it has two nice payoff cards. I'll get another card to work with. I think that this is probably worth trying out, but it's not the strongest hand I've ever seen, but it's also not the worst. But I think it's in the realm of keepable, so I'll keep it and see what my opponent's up to. It's a little slow and not particularly... Ooh, a mirror match with a opal. That's probably bad for me. Okay, well, they'll have a big turn next turn, that's for sure. So that certainly helps. Play my Nexus, my drum. And I'm trying to think if there's any reason if I should or shouldn't play the Ornithopter. I'm just gonna play the Ornithopter. This way I'm repping a Galv Blast, which might give my opponent something to think about. So I'm going to go ahead and play this Master of Ethereum. Go from there. This is going to be a disaster. It's a lot of steel overseers. That is a ton of steel overseers. So I drew a mountain that I don't need, so I'll play this. Now, what is my plan? I could play plating, equip, and an ornithopter. I think that might just be the play here. Because that adds two more artifacts. That'll make this a 7/7. It's 14. That's almost lethal. And I'll have two drums, so I could theoretically equip at instant speed next turn. Maybe a little bit of a pipe dream. So let's play the plating. I could also just put the plating on the thopter here. Oh, then I won't be able to play the drum. But then my opponent could chump block. Is it better to make my opponent chump block with the steel overseer, or is it better to just deal 6 damage? I think it's probably just better to put it on the ornithopter here. Equip. So we'll attack with both. See how far that gets us. Our opponent's stuff's going to be so big next turn. All right, let's see if I'm dead. Because everything gets four counters here. All right, let's see what I can do here. Cast that. And cast. The drum. Cast Ravager. I can animate my Nexus. So my opponent only has one flyer, and I believe I have two lethal threats. So as long as my opponent's last card's not a Galvanic Blast, I think, and even if it is, I might still have this. So let's try F2 to attack. So let's see, when they block, I think I can just move the plating. So black. Make black. And I think that's going to be a game. All right. That was a lot of Steel Overseers, but my draw was just nimble enough to get around it and win the game at the last second. So, etch champion, pretty bad. I like Aether Grid a lot. I like Ancient Grudge. Those are really the cards that I would like here, I think. What to take out? Overseer's great. Plating's only okay. It's kind of mana intensive. I like to board plating out. Not all of them, but just like maybe one or two. I still want to be nimble. The Thopters get worse, so maybe I can board out like an Ornithopter, because there's so many flyers. An Ornithopter. A plating. I'd like to cut maybe like one colored spell since I'm bringing in three. So maybe I'll board out like a Galvanic Blast. All right. That makes sense to me. Let's run it like that. So I had four cards boarded out. I just brought one of the Ornithopters back in, because I boarded out the champion before I started sideboarding, because I knew that I wanted to board that out. I think this is probably okay. It's not the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life, but it does have the Grid, which can be a pretty big game. It has an Overseer, which is one of the best cards. It has artifacts, so I'm going to give this a whirl. Let's see what my opponent's up to. My opponent mulliganed, I'm going to keep. Fast start again. So do another Overseer. So I'll play the Nexus. I'll play my Ornithopter. Okay, it's my signal post. And hopefully we don't get, wrecked too hard here. Also, hopefully we could pick up, an Opal and get this, slam this GURP or Aether Grid onto the board. Gets a lot worse if my opponent has a Steel Overseer in play when I play it. Okay. Huh. So, my opponent doesn't have Metalcraft yet. So I think I'm just going to play the Spire in case there's like a Hercule's recall. I don't need to get all my lands also bounced. I'll play my Overseer. And then no reason to attack since the Nexus will just eat my Signal Pest. So I'll just ship it. So if I'm making Metalcraft to potentially play something, Galvanic Blast, okay. So hopefully my opponent has something that I can kill with the Aether Grid right away. And that hopefully the Aether Grid can kind of just take over the game here. Opponent has two cards left. Just kind of need to fade something really busted for one turn and go from there. Ooh, that's a nice card. Nice little mulligan fixer. So I could play my Aether Grid, or I could just dump like a Master into play, but I think I just want to get my Aether Grid down. You could get like Spell Pierce, but I really don't think that they would have Spell Pierce. I mean, they could. Anything can happen. But this kind of gives all my creatures comes into play abilities for the rest of the game. So, hopefully my opponent doesn't have a Wear Tear in their hand to 2-for-1 me, but I'm not getting 2-for-1 like super hard here. Ravager. Plating. Let's not shoot our own creature. I'll shoot the Ravager. 'Force my opponent to sacrifice something. I'm cool with this exchange. Very cool with this exchange. So I can play the Master. Or the Overseer and the Drum. So play the Drum. Maybe I should play the Overseer since its ability is the next turn I'll be able to shoot down the Ornithopter that's, I assume, going to wear a plating. It's not a big plating, and I can keep the little creatures kind of in check. So it appears as though it's my opponent's turn to be nimble through the control this game. But I should have some answers for this soon. Hopefully. So I can only do 2 damage, so I might as well just go upstairs. So I drew a pest. Make blue. Then I can just play the, this is 1, 2, will be 3 shots. But also I can put a counter on all my creatures. All right, time to do a little bit of math. But I think this goes fairly poorly for me. So if I block, this will be 2, 3. I'm 1 short. 1, 2, 3. So I can activate this Blink Moth Nexus at least. I think I need to jump here. So, make a mana, turn ink blank moth into a creature. What wouldn't I do for an Ancient Grudge right now, huh? Let's see what I draw. Ooh, a Galvanic Blast. That is very interesting. Two. So I have one, two, three pings. So I think I'm just going to pass the turn. I think I should attack. This is going to be close. I'm not exactly sure how this is going to play out, but I'm hoping that I can kind of trap my opponent here. This is an interesting game, that's for sure. So so I can ping it down. be able to get some chip damage in here, and depending on what happens, I might be able to force my opponent into a bad blocking situation next turn, but probably not. So animate this. Use the Overseer. We'll go upstairs a couple times. So now I have a plating. I will cast my plating. The question is, do I attack? If I attack, it's going to cost me the ability. It costs me a lot to attack with the plating. So my opponent can animate two things and put two platings on, but I can ping 1, 2, 3, 4 times. So I think this is okay. I think I just want to hold Pat here. See what happens. One, two, three, four. I can ping 4 times if necessary. And then next turn, I'll put the plating on something and try and attack. Because it won't cost me too much. In order to attack, it costs me, you know, a ping. So let's see what my opponent's up to over there. I'm running a little low on time, which is unfortunate, but hopefully I can get this game. Short of my opponent drawing something completely insane, I think I'm in decent shape. A Ravager, I think, gets me killed. Or close to it, at least. So they can equip it instant speed, but they don't have enough lands to make. I mean, the best they can do is really just make two Nexi. At least on board, that's the scariest thing that they can do. That's a big flying infector. Two, three, four. So I can ping it down even if my opponent tries to pump. Oh, wait a sec. I'm short one. So if they pump with the Nexus, I only have one, two, three pings. So I need to block. So I wait. I messed up, but I caught it just in time. So I'll go upstairs, I guess. I hope that 1 point doesn't cost me. That 1 point might cost me. All right. Let's guess this. So opponent's at 13. And I have 11 artifacts in play. I'm pretty sure this attack is just lethal. My opponent only has 3 blockers. And I can use this to move the plating onto whatever my opponent doesn't block. So main phase. Beginning of combat. So if I attack with everything, my opponent can only block 3 things, and then I can move the plating onto whatever doesn't get blocked. Tap the Memnite and add black. All right, got that one. That was a little tricky. I don't even know if the Aether Grid was like good. I think the Aether Grid kind of was good. So hard to say, but. Whew, bailed myself out of almost getting wrecked by an onboard trick there, but pulled it off anyway. All right, see you for another round. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. Brian DeMars here, playing some Affinity. I won the die roll, so I'll take the play. And let's see what I've got. Got a Drum Ornithopter Scourge hand into an Overseer. I mean, I wish I had another land, but I think this hand is still good enough to just keep on the play, so I'll keep. A land would probably be a good draw at some point. Opponent mulliganed. So I'll go Nexus, Drum, Ornithopter. I'll make Mana. And then I'll cast my Vault Scourge. And that'll do it. So let's see what we're playing against so we can... Oh, Affinity again. Okay, sure. Opponent's hand pretty strong. So and go Drum into Overseer, I guess. Overseer down and pass the turn. Okay, didn't have the Galve Blast. That's something. Opponent has their own Overseer. And another Overseer. I really hope I draw like a land, then I can play the master and kill my opponent's stuff. So no need to be super greedy here. I'm just gonna kill off both my opponent's Steel Overseers. They don't have a ton else going on, so I'll make red. Yep, the Vault Scourge. Make red. Kill the Vault Scourge. Turn Ink Moth Nexus into a creature. And put a plus one counter on my team. Okay, that's a good draw for my opponent there. 6/6 master. Let me take my beats here. Decent draw will allow me to do some stuff. So what is the play? This master will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then 7 with the counter. So for sure, need to make blue. I'll tap the Thopter. I'll play the master. then I think I'm just going to leave it all home because hopefully the Volt Scourge will hold back these, and then I'll... Okay, my opponent just conceded because they're super dead and I have everything and they have nothing. All right. Now, last time I brought in the Aether Grids, they weren't great. I definitely don't want the Champion. I think I want the Grudge. Maybe one Aether Grid here. So I'll board out. I'll bring in the Aether Grid for the Etch Champion. I'll bring in a Grudge for a Plating. So I don't love plating. I definitely don't love drawing a bunch of platings. The question is, do I want the second Aether Grid? On the draw, probably. On the play, I'll probably bring in another Aether Grid, but on the draw, I'm just going to do one. Because it wasn't like as good as I hoped it would be. So. It's not great, but it is definitely acceptable. I feel like I say that about every Affinity hand. So keep. I mean, I'm going to try it for sure. Must be nice to have an Opal. I never have Opal. Oh my goodness. I'm getting run right over. See, this is why I board out platings. Now I wish I boarded out more platings. So I'll play a Nexus. I'll play my Memnite. I'll play the Volt Scourge. Things go super wrong. Maybe I can get a plating on a Volt Scourge. A Citadel. What is one card? I'll play the Ravager. Just to create a little bit of a board presence. I mean, I'm pretty vulnerable right now. Having a plating in play isn't going to help a ton. At least I might be able to surprise my opponent with the plating. So there's another little Nexi. I'll play the Nexus. I think it's time to play the plating. Now, if I equip, what am I equipping to? One, two, three, four artifacts, so I'll make my guy five power. The Vault Scourge will force my opponent to sacrifice a Ravager to trade with the Vault Scourge, so that'll be a 2-for-1. I feel like that's probably, and it'll gain me five life. So let's try that. I'll go to combat. 6-1. How big can my opponent make this Ornithopter? If they sack everything, I guess it would live. Yeah, I'm cool if they want to sack everything to make a giant Ornithopter. I feel like I'll have a way to beat that. Perfect. Delightful. Right. Play my land. Play my drum. Play plating. Signal passed. All in black. Kept the signal passed. Equipped to the Memnite. Yeah, I probably should have put that on the Vault Scourge. Because my opponent's just going to trade the Memnite with the Memnite. So that was kind of a waste. I could have gained like 9 more life. That was not the greatest play I've ever seen in my entire life. Let's see what my opponent's going to do. I mean, things could get awkward. My opponent has mana up. I feel like the Memnite should go here, and then the Thopter probably needs to go here, and then one of these Ravagers needs to be sacked to trade with the Vault Scourge. Which is good, because, you know, I'm getting a 2-for-1 out of that and gaining 9 life. I mean, if my opponent has a Galvanic Blast or a Ancient Grudge or something, I think that this is just a lot easier for them. They could just blow up my flyer and go about their merry way, but I don't know. They're in the tank. I feel like this is an important turn for my opponent, because they were behind last turn. They didn't add anything. So they need to make a move. They obviously didn't like exchanging the Ornithopter with the Vault Scourge, but they were trying to draw to something that they probably didn't get. I mean, an Aether Grid would be insane on this board. So another reason to force my opponent to make all these exchanges is that it kind of takes Aether Grid out of the equation to some extent. The Aether Grid's not nearly as devastating. So maybe I'm genius. Maybe I'm terrible, maybe I'm genius. I don't know. I didn't really put as much thought into it as I probably should have. So they get to sack the Ravager to the other Ravager. But it's still a 2-for-1. They're up a +1/+1 counter, but oh. So they have Ancient Grudge. So I will I guess I might as well do this as well. So they have a grudge, which is great. But I still have a plating. And I still have a big Ravager. So I get to move the counters over there. They don't have the grudge anymore. They have their own plating. And another opal, I presume. I'm getting aided here. That went from feeling pretty good to this game's pretty close. So there's another Ravager. That's fairly decent. So I should probably play the Ravager. So if I put the plating on something, I'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 power. So I'm going to do that. So make black. I'll equip. So this isn't, is it, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I'll animate the ink moth. Attack. With both. All right. All right, this is going to take some math to figure out here. But probably not too much math. So I now have double black off of the drum and the glimmer void and the arcbound ravager. So if I need to deal 11 damage, and this is 3. Four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. So if I animate, what happens if I just put it on signal pass? That'd be three, four, five, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. That only puts my opponent to 1, huh? 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm 1 short. But I think that's still a fine play. And I'll pretty much have my bases covered here. So let's attach. I don't have enough to animate two things. Yeah, I'm 1 mana short, so just do this. Just this little 8/4. I could have gotten one more point, but I don't want to die to an ancient grudge. I guess I wasn't really dead to an ancient grudge to begin with. And if my opponent bashes with the Ravager, I can actually equip at instant speed to eat my opponent's Ravager. So we'll attach. Instant speed. group. This is going to be interesting because I need to decide where to put the counter. I think the counter needs to go on to Blink Moth Nexus. This is a close one here. Insect thing. So I think I'm actually going to sacrifice my drum so that my Blink Moth Nexus can be a little bit bigger. I think my opponent has priority for some reason right now. Oh, it went back to my opponent after I animated. And then I'm going to sacrifice the Springleaf Drum to make my Blink Moth Nexus a 3/3. Now that this combat's going to happen. All right, so I don't think I can win next turn, but I'm going to try. So that is a lethal threat, so it has to be blocked. So my opponent probably suit up this Ornithopter here. Well, how about that little draw, huh? How about the Ornithopter? Nice little draw. Best possible card. Wasn't sure which one I was targeting. The Cranial Plating, it kind of looked like it could have gone either way, but hey, a win's a win. Sometimes you draw a good card every once in a while. See you guys and gals soon for round four. Hello, everybody, and welcome back. Brian DeMars here for ChannelFireball.com. This is round five of the league, even though it's the fourth video in the series here. Moto kept crashing, and I lost due to timing out and moto crashing. I'll be filing for compensation, which is great, but I figured a video of moto crashing and me cursing at the screen would not be ideal. So this is round five, and it's quite unkeepable. So Moto must have heard me complaining about my timing out misfortune and giving me no lands. Moto's like that. It's pretty fickle. So let's mulligan, see if we can get a better six. This will work. It's just turn one plating and an Ornithopter, but lots of mana, so I can play anything I draw. I'll keep. I get a scry. I'm going to look for a payoff card. This is not a payoff card, so we'll put it on the bottom. So Mutavault, probably Merfolk's. Another drum. So we got Opal. Citadel. Drum. Ornithopter. And plating. So, pretty decent. If I play the drum next turn, I'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 artifacts in play, so I'll be attacking for 6 at the bare minimum. And hopefully I can draw something else. They don't have a land, it looks like. So there's a Nexus, which is nice. Play my drum. Equip my plating. Go to combat. Bash and then animate the Nexus. Hopefully they don't have like a dismember. All right, they don't. So this is like a 3-turn clock here. If I draw a creature, I'll have instant speed equip on the plating. Or I don't even need that because I have the Spire. The Spire is instant speed equip. So I can play through a bounce spell. I think with my opponent just missing all their land drops, they're probably in a very bad place if they don't come up with like some kind of way of dealing with something here. Cast the Thopter. Cast the Spire. I probably shouldn't have cast the Spire, to be honest. I should have just attacked first, because the Ornithopter will move at instant speed, so... So that was a mistake. Hopefully it doesn't matter. I wasn't thinking too much, but my opponent could have the Harbinger to bounce one of these creatures. But I think they're kind of roped into having to bounce this Ornithopter. So I can just replay the Ornithopter. All right, just a couple of Ornithopters, no big deal. Oh, I could have equipped two. I should have. I'll still be able to equip the Ornithopter, animate the Nexus, and then I can leave back the second Thopter to... Oh, I can just instant speed equip. It'll cost me a damage, but I'm happy to do it. On my opponent's end step, I can just pay a black, make a black, move the plating onto a Thopter. But my opponent's just dead, so it's like sort of irrelevant. So, what do I want against Merfolk? This is not a matchup that I've actually played very much, so I'm going to have to think a little bit. So let's just go through it. I do not want Rule of Law. I do not want Ancient Grudge. I do not want Bitter Blossom. I do not want Cage. But these cards are all kind of medium, so... I think I like Galvanic Blast as my removal spell, which means I probably don't want Dispatch. I think Master is fine. I think Champion is fine. I could have Grid, so maybe I do want Grid. Just to eat up my opponent's creatures. So let's see what happens if I bring in a couple Grids. Spell Pierce and Thoughtseize. I think I just want Grids. I'm going to board out a Champion because it's hard to block their Champion's a lot better when it's blocking. And then I'll board out one Cranial Plating just so I don't flood on them. And I'll hopefully just draw a Grid and be able to eat all of my opponent's creatures. Or just have a fast draw and go crazy. The best spell that they can sideboard is probably like a Hercule's Recall. So this hand's actually okay for a no lander. The Opal will be turned on, and then I can play the Drum, and then I can Galvanic Blast, and then the next turn I'll be able to play Ravager. So I'm going to try this one lander. It feels functional. It looks functional. You know, assuming things don't go too wrong. And I'll get another card, so I could just get a land and just dump this Ravager on the first turn if I get a land. Then I'd have two Thopters, a Ravager, and three mana on play, be able to slam the Master on the next turn. So they have the Aether Vial. Good start. Let's see if I get that land. Nope. So let's go Opal. Thopter. Thopter. Drum. And now I have Galvanic Blast up. Is there anything else? I can only make one mana and I have a Galvanic Blast, so I don't have any further plays. And I'm not going to F6. I think this is a good enough exchange. I'm going to be tight on mana anyway. So, if they have the Curse Catcher, they have the Curse Catcher. But I'm using my mana in a game. Where my mana is constrained. Okay, that was a good little exchange, I believe. It's better than it getting Curse Catchered. So I think the Overseer is what I'm going to do here. It's the one that has the most upside as the game continues to go. I'd rather be able to tap this and get some counters. To spread around, I do have three creatures. So, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised to see like a Vapor Snag or something, but being that I have 2 3 mana plays and 2 2 mana plays, I think the one with the continues to grow upside is probably better here. I'll just need to dodge like a Hercule's Recall. But I still have 20 hit points. I ate one of my opponent's lands, which is kind of nice. Huh. Well, I think this is the one to play. And then I'm going to wait. I want my opponent to tick that Aether Vial up to 3 so that I don't get Harbingered. Because I really need this to live. So I'll probably just take the 4 here. Now it's 6. I don't know if I can race. The plating will help if I can draw land, but they left it on 2, which is really bad for me. All right, so I can I can block, put a counter on my team. And then sacrifice something to trade, and then I could move the counters. Not really in position to. Do much else. I don't really want to take 6, but I also don't want to just trade a Ravager with nothing, you know? And I can't sack my mana sources, so I think I just have to take this six here. Stinks, but my draw really did not come together very well. At least I don't have a land, so I can't get Spreading Seized. If my opponent doesn't have the Harbinger here, it'll be great. I expect that they do. Maybe I should have waited. Got a Nexus. I think I'm just going to replay Steel Overseer and try and, you know, I think I just need this guy. I think I just need the beef in the play. If I get wrecked, I get wrecked. I can't stop a Spreading Seas, but my opponent doesn't have the land yet. I'm just short on mana, and I don't think that just playing a Steel Overseer is going to get me out of this. I think that doesn't really beat the board, which is why I'm not doing it. I would love to be able to leave mana up to sack this Ink Moth Nexus so that my opponent can't Island Walk me, but I just don't think that that's really an option at this point, because if I play just the Overseer, I'm just gonna, I mean, what are my blocks? I'm just dead. At least this, if they miss their land or don't have, you know, they could also, yeah, I think I'm getting wrecked. They only have two cards. I do think I'm getting wrecked, but this whole game has been getting wrecked, so I made a play that beats what I think I can actually beat. Yeah, no attack. Nice. All right, another Nexus. And go Overseer Signal Pest here. And that lets me leave up a mana to activate my Nexus. This is still on two, so I don't really want to attack. Make my opponent have to bounce an Ornithopter next turn. So I can now beat, I can't beat Hercule's Recall, but I can now beat like a Spreading Seas. And I'm just going to build my forces. And I'll lose to a Hercule's Recall if they have it. But there, I don't know what I'm supposed to do about a Hercule's Recall if they have it. Maybe I needed to board in like Thoughtseize or something. So they don't have the Hercules because I would be dead. 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. They go to 1. I feel like they would just burn that there. Oh, wow. One ping, two ping, three pings. Like, this is just safer. One, two, three. So I can take out the Lord. So I'm just going to go after the Lord on the end step. And I could ping something else. I could ping my opponent. So this, I think I will. I mean, I don't really care if something gets bounced here. I'm just taking my opponent apart piece by piece. This Aether Grid is so unreal. I love playing with Aether Grid. As long as I keep all my opponent's creatures off the board, doesn't really... matter if they bounce my stuff. I'll just replay it. I'm just grinding my opponent completely out here. There's a Memnite. Play my Ravager. I'm gonna leave my plating so that I don't get island walked out, but I can ping 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this will be a big turn here for grinding my opponent out. I'll just keep doing it all on the end step so that I can play around lords and stuff. They put the Lord in, I'll just destroy the Lord. By not playing the plating, I also get to tap this Overseer. It's getting pretty close to where I can just win the game, but the reason I'm not winning the game is because I don't want to get blown out by a Hercule's Recall and then getting alpha'd. I want to kill my opponent's creatures first. Then it makes Hercule's Recall like completely irrelevant. I feel a harbinger. Try and kill this one. There's probably a lord that's going to come down to save it, but then I'll be able to pick the lord off next turn. I'll put a plus one counter on my whole team. Let's see what they got. The Aether Grid is truly an amazing card in these creature mirrors because it just gives you infinite removal, especially when your opponents are fairly small creatures. Against Affinity and Merfolk, they do have Lords, which if you fall too far behind, the Aether Grid won't bail you out, but like in these board stall situations... it's just pretty insane. So let's just go after these creatures here and then we can start attacking. Tap. Tap. Tap, tap. I'll just attack with my... should I attack for lethal here? Six. Oh, it's only 16. 12. Oh, I could have equipped the plating. For lethal here, but I didn't. I just can't imagine that there's really too many ways I can lose. I don't think my opponent knew that that could kill the Aether Grid. Sad. I also could have sacrificed it to the Ravager. My opponent has one card. I have like 800 things in play. I just can't lose. Just trying to get it over with here. So on the end step, I'm going to put counter on all my creatures. Another Steel Overseer. This should do it. I mean, they could have Hercules, but... I mean, their last card has to be a bounce spell of some sort, or they just lose. All right, Phantasmal Image. For an Ornithopter to block. Oh, I should have pinged it before it blocked. I'm just so over this game right now. I don't think there's like anything my opponent can do to get out of this. But yeah, I should have won the game that turn. To go to combat. Bring this guy, and this guy. And I have instant speed equip on the cranial plating for a bounce spell. So it's got to be like exactly Hercules Recall. All right. All right, we got that one. So that's pretty much Affinity there in a nutshell. Pretty powerful, pretty great. I think what I'm going to do, I think I'm going to play one more match, even though the league is over, just because the one match I was talking about, I had to scrap it because I kept disconnecting. So I'll give you one more bonus match with the Affinity. I'm going to join another league, and I'll be back in a minute. Hello, everybody. Welcome back for the bonus round. I went 4-1 in the league, losing to Moto Crashing. Now, one more match just for funsies. And I think this hand's pretty good. Turn one, I get to play Drum, Memnite, and Vault Scourge. So let's keep this. So probably a Coco deck of some sort. Oh, Boggles. This could be bad. So I drew a Nexus. I'm going to go Opal. Memnite. Now the question is, do I want to get this Ink Moth in play? Because I'll get Metalcraft pretty much no matter what, too. If I play the Citadel... Okay, so if I play the Nexus, I can use the Nexus to play the Drum, and then I can play Steel Overseer. Or I could play Vault Scourge and Signal Pest. I think I just want to get the Steel Overseer down. I'll be able to dump the rest of my hand next turn and attack with an Infect creature. So if my opponent has, like, a bunch of lifelink, I'll be infecting, which will be nice.
Ethereal armor, sure.
So pretty good starts on both sides. It doesn't have trample yet, which is kind of nice. Or lifelink. So I'm definitely playing the Citadel. Play the Pest. Play the Vault Scourge. So I can chump block. If I play this Opal, I don't really want to attack for one. Maybe I should. This isn't going to chump block, so I can. This isn't chump blocking your first striker. Attack for two. This will be two. Next turn will be four. So I might as well take the damage because I think that unless he makes my opponent can make this thing 14 power, I won't have to chump. Maybe I should just leave this back just in case he can't. My opponent can make it that big. So I'll get him for two. If my opponent makes it huge and it doesn't have trample, I might actually want to chump here. I don't think I'm racing on the ground. I have to save that Opal. So I have cranial plating equip is on the table if I draw that off the top. So this is seven. That'll put me to seven. And I'm not blocking a trampler. My plan is all in on infect damage. So I can play the second Overseer. I can play another Opal to animate the Nexus. So if I attack, I'll be attacking for two. If I put a counter on, it'll be three. I'll have two, three. So if I can attack for four, I don't need four. I think three is what I actually need. Three puts me to five. Oh, maybe not. Three puts me to five. And then I'll have to deal five next turn. This will be three, four, five. This is tricky. Three. I can attack with the Volt Scourge too. So I think this has to happen now. Three. So I think I need to attack with everything but these, and then I'll gain three. And hope my opponent can't. This is two, five, six, seven, eight. So my opponent will have to come up with eight more damage next turn. It's close. I don't know if they can get eight more. It's actually nine because the Signal Pest will get gives the Vault Scourge one more. So I have five power back, and this is lethal next, and the one creature is lethal all by itself next turn. So as long as I can fade removal, oh no! Alright, I needed to leave the Vault Scourge back, I suppose. Because I'm getting killed for Xaxes. Alright, I wasn't thinking about the Griff Spoon, but that was my mistake. This would have saved me. Ooh, that was rough. Alright, there was a reason for what I was doing, it just didn't wind up working. So, Thoughtseize and Spell Pierce coming in. I think I'm going to board out some Masters. Ooh, I could probably leave in Masters. Board out Galvanic Blasts. Alright, let's run it like this. Man, that was a close game. I feel really bad about losing that one. It was not wise. It was ill-advised. Because I would have won. Although, maybe not, because the giant creature can just hang out at home. It doesn't have to attack. But if that creature's not attacking, I don't think I'm losing. That's the kind of loss that would eat you up at a tournament. I feel real bad about that. And now I'm going to get beat up by sideboard cards, so I did bring in my spell pierces and whatnot. I think this is fine. Let's keep. I can't have a turn one Thoughtseize, but I'll have a turn two Thoughtseize. So let's play the Ink Moth, the Pest. Actually, let's play the Vault Scourge. The Memnite. I'll play the Opal. I can just fire off the Thoughtseize right now. This is a Spider Umbra, a Slippery Boggle, a Seal of Primordium, a Hyena Umbra, and a Coronet, so I'll take the Slippery Boggle. So not bad, I got their only creature, which should buy me a little bit of time. The seal's a little bit concerning, but... So I guess I have options. I can attack for one. Play the pest or cranial plating. Make my opponent use it next turn. So I think I'm just going to do that. Let's cast this. Fire up this Nexus. Go to combat. Hit him for two. Oh. Well. Should have fired up the other one. Played the wrong one. Next turn. My opponent will play the seal here, I assume, and I'll go for the after combat plating if they put the seal down. Okay. Deece. Getting a big chunk here, getting 10 in. I think this forces my opponent to play the seal and seal away the cranial plating. Maybe not. Maybe they just want to grind my creatures out with their flying reach monster. Probably not, though. I mean, they'll get it. The Umbra will get it back, I suppose. I don't think that necessarily helps, but let's fire this creature up. Let's move the plating onto the Ornithopter. And then go to combat. Put my opponent down to two. So as long as they can't get lifelink, a ton of lifelink, I should be all right here. Or if I draw a Ravager, I'd be all right as well. Oh no. Now I need a Ravager. Oh my goodness, I'm super dead. Well, that wasn't the one that I really needed there. My opponent still has the seal to take care of the plating. I don't think there's really like much of a way out of this. Let's see if I can get something that helps. That does not help. I'm super dead. What can I even draw to like deal with this? I could have fired up my things. I'm just dead though. There's no real way out of this nonsense. So, chump. Need a Ravager is what I need to stop this life gain. So I keep the untapped one. Main phase, combat. So hopefully missing that damage won't cost me, but it probably will. Just not very good play. I think I have to take this here. Now I am dead to a trample spell. But I need the damage or else I can't possibly win. Alright, that's a rough one. Huh, there's the Ravager I needed. It looks like that 2 damage matters a ton. Oh, man. All right. Beginning of combat. I have to chump. So my opponent will gain at least 7. So if my opponent is Stone Cold nothing, I think I win. If they have anything, I don't think I can win. Oh, I'm super dead. All right, well, that was my bad. I missed the opportunity to get 2 damage, and it wound up costing me really big. Let's see if there's something I can draw. I don't think there is. My opponent's just gaining more life than I can deal, and I'm locked out of many of the cards in my deck. Yep, I am dead. I'm hard locked. So, yeah, that was not great, but it really shows you the, you know, missing those 1 or 2 points of damage makes a big difference over a game, over a match, over a tournament. So, geez, that's kind of embarrassing. But anyway, Affinity is still great. It's a great deck. As you can see, my opponent had pretty great draw, and I still had a chance to win it if I would have played a little bit tighter there at the end. So, all things considered, Affinity probably one of the best overall choices to play in Modern. I've been writing about that a little bit. Last week I wrote an article about the 5 decks that I considered tier 1 according to sort of metagame top 8 data. And Affinity was like right up there at the top. I think it was number 2 or 3, and for good reason. The deck is super aggressive and has a lot of play. It's very fast. It has a lot of synergy. You can do a lot of things over the course of the video. I think I won some games that were pretty weird. It didn't really look like I was going to be able to win, but then a bunch of damage came out of nowhere, or some really powerful card hit the board, and that's sort of the story of playing Affinity. The cards are so strong. Plating, Ravager, all this stuff. So, but then again, the biggest Achilles heel of the Affinity isn't really matchups, it's sideboard cards, like the Stony Silence up here. That's one of the ways you lose a lot of games, is the sideboard cards just come down and they wreck you and you lose. So that's sort of the upside, is you get to play probably the best deck in the format. The downside is there are really messed up sideboard cards for the best deck in the format, which sort of keeps it from running away with the format and just being unbeatable, because, you know, any Joker, not Joker, but any, you know, Boggles player, Abzan player, whatever. They can just slam this card, Stony Silence or Creeping Corrosion or Ancient Grudge or whatever, and it really, really, really makes it hard for the Affinity deck to win. So anyway, that's five rounds with Affinity. Came back to do a bonus one only to make a small mistake not paying attention and get absolutely wrecked because of it. But 4-0 was pretty decent before I forgot to animate both of my Nexuses to deal lethal damage. But anyway, if you have any comments about the video or the deck or the sideboard or whatever, drop them in the comments section below. I check those and I try and respond. I interact. So if you have any questions, you have any ideas, whatever, feel free to share them with me and with the other viewers out there and get a little dialogue started. If you like the video, also be sure to hit the like button. That stuff matters for me. And if you like the video, be sure to subscribe to the Channel Fireball YouTube page. There's a ton of content, a lot of really great content providers out there for Channel Fireball right now. So it's a great way to keep ahead of the competition, see what the best minds in the game are up to, what they're thinking, how they're approaching matchups, what plays they're making, all that good stuff. So whether you're, you know, practicing for Friday Night Magic, PPTQ, RPTQ, which I'm practicing for right now, watching those videos, subscribing to that channel is a great way to get some work done while also being entertained. So I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in. This was Brian DeMars for ChannelFireball.com playing Modern Affinity, and have a great week.